This
Any
conference
idea?
will now be recorded.
Yeah, so if you don't have any idea, maybe I will try to explain a little bit so that you get some overall idea on the data warehouse and SQL.
Oh, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, I know about database, so SQL.
Okay,
and
SQL, you know, and have you ever worked on in any data warehouse development?
Well, not the development part, talking about SQL Server, you know, data warehouse analysis services. So I know cube creations and data refresh and security kind of the things and ETL process and
okay, so you know what a data warehouse is, so you have the clear idea. What about the rest of the students, Srinivash and Shruti?
Saurav, I have worked on SAP BW. Currently, I'm working on SAP HANA.
Hello, is someone speaking?
Yes, myself, Srinivas, I'm speaking. Can you hear me?
Yes, Srinivas, I can hear you. I got the idea. So you also know SQL and data warehouse. How about Shruti? Shruti, have you ever worked on any data warehouse or SQL? Okay, let me consider that everyone is aware of SQL and data warehouse. So let us start the demo. Why I asked this question, the reason is why Snowflake all of a sudden? Recently, the Snowflake demand is on high, right? So the purpose Snowflake is specifically caters to the data warehouse need. Okay, it has nothing to do with OLTP development. It is exclusively caters the OLAP data warehouse development. In data warehouse, how we are going to use Snowflake, what are the explicit benefits of Snowflake, that we will got to know with the course. That's the entire objective. And if you if you working as a developer or as an architect or maybe in pre-sales, you need to know why Snowflake. Okay, because if you are using it, you are going to propose it to somewhere, you need to explain them that what benefit will they get if they use Snowflake. Okay, now let us start our demo. So this is the overall architecture. So this architecture, Snowflake has a three layer of architecture. It's a SaaS product. SaaS means software as a service, cloud product. So it has a three layer of architecture. One is cloud services, another is query processing, and third one is database storage. So Snowflake has a separate costing for storage, query processing, and cloud services. Okay. Now, if we compare it with the legacy, any legacy database like Oracle or SQL Server, there is no such concept. Even cloud database like Redshift, now they have introduced, but earlier there was no such concept of storage and query processing separate cost. So cost is one important parameter in cloud, because whatever we are going to use, we have to pay cost. So in Snowflake, the storage and query processing is segregated. Okay, now data storage, whatever data we are storing in the database is going to incur us storage cost. Now Snowflake keep the data in compressed format automatically with AS/256 encryption at the rest. So this storage will always cost us some storage cost, the database storage, but the query processing will cost us only for the time we are going to use the Snowflake compute capability. And cloud services is a layer on top of everything, okay, which facilitate that entire query execution. Now we'll go in detail that what a cloud, what about all these three layers. Okay, we need to understand this architecture very clearly and perfectly so that, you know, we can further go ahead with this Snowflake course. Now, Snowflake provides a hybrid architecture of shared disk and shared nothing. Okay, Snowflake has a central data repository and multiple massive parallel processing, MPP, petabyte scale database. It's a columnar storage database. And Snowflake, now let me explain what is a shared disk and shared nothing. After that, I'll go back to the previous slide. So this is a shared disk architecture. If you see, this is a common network disk, and we have, let's say, three different compute cluster, 1, 2, and 3, three different node, okay. Now everyone can access the same data at the same time, okay. I have same data, like you can consider a shared disk as maybe Oracle or SQL Server, okay. So in Oracle, we have something, the server version, Oracle server database in the server, and from Oracle client, we are pointing to the same database. Now let's say we have an employee table. So at the time when developer one is trying to access that employee table and it's trying to update something, Oracle provides an explicit lock on that particular row. And at the same time, no one else can modify that record, or no one else can insert any record on that particular, update that record on that particular row. So this is a shared disk architecture. What are the advantages and disadvantages of this shared disk architecture? Now, clearly in this shared disk architecture, there is a locking, right? So lock, because of this locking, it's slowing down, it will slow down the performance, because if developer one is trying to update anything, developer two will not be able to do anything on that particular table. But at the same time, it will provide ease with respect to the data management, because we have a centralized database and we don't need to manage that centralized data explicitly, because it will automatically be managed. That's why the locking is there. So there will not be any such scenario when developer one has updated something and developer two has updated something and we have two separate copies of data. We'll always have a single version of truth, single version of the database, and all other, you know, developers will access the same data. So that is a shared disk architecture. And what is shared nothing architecture? So shared nothing architecture has clearly multiple database disk, okay, multiple, and based on that network, everyone is every single node is going to access that data locally, okay. Now you can see in this example there are three disks. Now compute node 1, 2, and 3, everyone is accessing a separate database. Now let's say in compute disk 2, in compute disk 1, we are triggering some loading where the data is present in disk 2. Okay, now by using that, you know, like a community network, node 1 can access the data from node 2 and can load it, but it will always have a separate version, okay, of the data. It has every processor has a local memory. Okay, so in this particular section, the performance is like scalability is high, performance will be much, much faster, because everyone is accessing from a local data and there will not be any locking or any such scenario. So no one has to wait. If on employee table, compute node one is trying to update anything, and from compute node two, they can update the employee table as well, because they have a separate copy, they have a local copy in their processor. So this is a shared nothing architecture. In this section, performance is definitely good, but Data management would be cumbersome because we need to, after that, at the end of the day, we need to establish a mechanism to create a single copy of the data because we have three separate informations in this example for three different compute nodes. Now, Snowflake is hybrid of shared disk and shared nothing. Snowflake has established a mechanism where it uses the best part of both the architecture. Now, how it used and how what are the different features in the Snowflake architecture, we'll explain. But before you go further, is there any question for me? Anyone has any understanding difficulties or like any questions on the topics till now I have explained?
Yeah, it is great, the explanation. I really appreciate it. I just want to know one thing. See, for example, I'm using a Synapse. Okay, and where this Snowflake will sits into the place?
I'm sorry, what you were using?
I'm using a Synapse, Azure Synapse. Where this Snowflake fit into the picture?
I have never worked on Azure Synapse. I have mainly worked on AWS cloud. So
okay. AWS, I'm using big data. Assume like I'm using a big data. Okay
yeah,
so that I have and EFS and whatever the Glacier storage is cheapest one or whatever maybe I'm using. Okay, so I'm using
right.
a big data technologies in AWS. Where this sits in top on that?
Yeah, so you have let's say you have a huge volume of data in your AWS S3 or maybe Azure Blob Storage. Now you need to implement data analytics. You need to implement data warehouse on that data. You have data in huge files. So Snowflake will facilitate you the data warehouse. Snowflake can help you to query that data by using external table. You can point it to Snowflake. Okay, Snowflake has external table as well, like other databases. So you can point it to Snowflake, and you don't need to load. Or if you want like better performance, you can load that data from that file to Snowflake tables, and from there you can generate your report. Okay, so the end product is reporting, right? In any data warehouse, we need to provide a insight to a business user. That's what data warehouse do. So Snowflake will help you to process the data from that storage by implementing a data warehouse. You can implement Star Schema or maybe Data Vault or any other type of modeling. So Snowflake will fit in that section. Is it
so
clear to you?
You mean to say you don't have any third-party tool, just like a UI, presenting to the user. And this tool is capable to read the raw files and make analytically very fast multi-locations and combine it and give to the report, isn't it?
Correct.
Is that what is do?
Yes. So by using external table, we can club it with, it's similar to Athena. Athena, AWS Athena will do the same thing, right? It has external table and it can read it from the file directly. So Snowflake has external table as well, and it can read from the file, or else we can load. Snowflake provide bulk loading options, so we can load those files into Snowflake, and then Snowflake we can implement some transformation logic if required, and we can populate a report work table. And from that report work table, like Power BI or Tableau, can read it from that work table and can generate report. So the processing part, data processing part, will happen in Snowflake, reading and processing.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. So anyone else has any question on that thing till now I have explained? Shared disk and shared nothing. I believe no one has any questions, so let me proceed further.
Yeah, this is Shruti.
Hey, hi Shruti.
Hi, here we are talking about how to decentralize the data and share those disks between all of them. Is that how we are doing it in AWS?
No, actually, I have explained shared disk and shared nothing. So in shared disk, there is a centralized database, and in shared nothing, it's a decentralized database. But Snowflake uses the hybrid of both this architecture. Snowflake uses the best part of both this architecture. Now we'll explain, okay. We'll see how Snowflake uses the hybrid architecture. Okay.
So shared nothing is like a traditional desk or a server client server type.
No, client server type is shared disk. Shared nothing shared. Where every processor has the local data. In this, if you see this
okay.
example, yeah. So now Snowflake has a central data repository in this like this data storage. Snowflake has a central data repository, and like every other, like this is the like central data repository system is like shared disk architecture. And what is shared nothing, where Snowflake implement that massive parallel processing compute cluster. So each time we are going to trigger any query in Snowflake, be it a select or insert into any table or update, we need to use virtual warehouses. Snowflake provides virtual warehouse in query processing layer. So what is virtual warehouse? We'll see in detail. What are the different types of virtual warehouse? We'll see in detail when we do that virtual warehouse explicit lecture. But till now, just understand that virtual warehouse are EC2 cluster, similar to EC2 clusters, like compute cluster. It provides you a small set, like let's say you can say it provides a small computer. Okay, I have my own server, own processor, own memory. If I use that particular compute cluster, it has the copy of that data. And so every virtual warehouse has the same copy of that particular data set. So it will scale, like scalability is logically unlimited. So this query processing part is shared nothing, where every processor maintains the local copy, and database storage part is the shared disk. And what is cloud services? Cloud services help us to implement authentication, infrastructure management, optimization, metadata management, security management. So any query we trigger in Snowflake, be it select or be it insert, it will always go through the cloud services. First, cloud services will check everything. Then it will send it to the query processing layer, where it will process. And at the end of the day, after the processing, it stores into the database storage. Okay, now we'll see in detail what database storage is and how it manages. Now Snowflake creates micro partitions in when it is saving the record inside it. It's an internal mechanism completely. We don't have much insight how it saves, but it manages entirely that compression, encryption, the file structure, metadata, statistics, everything it manages internally. We don't have to worry about anything and how it is showing, whether do we need to externally compress it, because Snowflake automatically compress and encrypt the data at rest. Okay. Now let's see, we'll see one example where we'll see in detail. Just give me a second. So can everyone can see my screen, right? So let's say we have a table like this. Okay, we have 24 records in this table. We have product ID, product name, store, and date. Now product ID we have from 1 to 9, it's repeated sometimes, okay. It's, let's say we're capturing sales information. Product name, we have 24 product names. We have stores in the cities, and we have date. Now, how Snowflake stores? So let me tell you, this is for our representation and understanding purpose. In actual scenario, of course, there are thousands of micro partitions in Snowflake, and we really cannot reproduce that in an Excel sheet. but this is for our understanding how it seems. So let's say in this 24 records, Snowflake creates 4 micro partitions. Okay, this is one micro partition, this is another micro partition, this one is the third micro partition, and this is the fourth micro partition. Now how it stores in the micro partition, look at the right side. These are the four micro partitions. So Snowflake stores like this: product ID, product name, stores data. So Snowflake is a columnar database with massive parallel processing and petabyte scale data processing. Not gigabyte, not terabyte. It can process up to petabyte scale data. So this is the product ID. So this is a column. So Snowflake stores this columnar record inside that micro partition, the columnar information together. Okay, that's how columnar storage is. So in the product ID, let's say it will store like this: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In the product name, it will store A, B, C, D, E, F. And the store, it will store like Hyderabad, Mumbai, Chennai, Delhi, Kolkata, Delhi. Hyderabad, Mumbai, Chennai, Delhi, Kolkata, Delhi, like that. Okay. In the date also, it will store that particular date column inside that micro partition together. So like this, it stores that data in 4 micro partitions. Okay. Now at any given time, let's say we need to fetch any information. Let's say we want to fetch information on this particular record. Record number 15. So this is our record number 15. This is our record number 15. Let me highlight it with green. Okay. Record number 15 has 3C Chennai, 28th February. So it will fetch like 3C Chennai, 28th February, like that. Okay. So it can process it like that. So in each micro partition, Snowflake externally stores the metadata. And that metadata, Snowflake actually stores it like a min max mode metadata storage. What min max storage is, that you will see. Okay, so it's something like that. Snowflake stores the minimum value like 1 and the maximum value 6 in that metadata, so that it can read the range. Okay, now anything comes within that limit, it will see that, okay, what are the ranges of this particular micro partition, and this value falls under which range, and it will look for that micro partition only and look inside that micro partition, so that the performance would be much, much faster, because it will discard the all other micro partition which are not required at all. So any question till that this storage section? Anyone has any question in that example? I'll explain it again. Feel free to let me know. Because if this architecture is not clear, I think it will be difficult to go through the course. Okay, thank you, Srinivas. So
what's happening here is we're just putting all these numbers in our micro partitions. So basically it's dividing and conquering. Row 1 through 6 is in one storage, 7 through 12, 13 to 18, 19 to 24. Now based on what we want to get and fetch, it's basically dividing and conquering. Okay.
Correct. So Snowflake stores the data internally like that. Internally, it creates thousands of micro partitions and stores the related information. And as it's a columnar database, it stores the column data, columnar information. Let's say the product ID is the column, right? So all these records together, but it has a micro partition. So it will store within that micro partition, what are the records in that particular column, stores it together.
Okay, so if I want to fetch column number 7, Then I'll go to the second partition.
You don't have to go anywhere. You can simply trigger that. Let's say the name of the table is product. So you can simply say that select star from product, where product ID is equal to 7. Now Snowflake internally goes to this section and it will say 7. Okay, this 7, then G, then BLR, then 2208. So that's what it is, right? 7G22. That's what it is. Yeah. So this micro partition management is explicitly done by Snowflake internally. Okay, we don't have to worry about it at all. Okay, but I explained it that how, you know, how Snowflake stores in its storage. What are the mechanism it follows? Okay, but that doesn't mean that we need to go and fetch it from any specific micro partition. We will trigger the select as we trigger from any other SQL. Okay. So now the next layer is query processing after storage. So query processing, I already discussed that query processing layer in Snowflake, it has a virtual, it provides a virtual warehouse for every query, like be it a select or be it insert, we need to provide a virtual warehouse. We need to explicitly mention that what virtual warehouse that query is going to use. And based on that, Snowflake cloud services layer routes that particular query through that virtual warehouse and it processes it. Now virtual warehouse, it's like a small compute cluster. So we have different types of virtual warehouse in Snowflake. Snowflake has a t-sharding of virtual warehouses from extra small to 4x large. We have multi-cluster warehouse as well. Now, what are these? This cannot be covered in this particular architecture class. We will discuss this in detail when we are going to discuss that virtual warehouse part. Now, each virtual warehouse is independent compute cluster that does not share anything, any compute resource. So this is the best part from shared nothing architecture. Till now, we have seen that database storage, that is a part of shared disk. Now, in shared nothing, this is query processing, that each virtual warehouse is an independent compute cluster that does not share compute resources with other virtual warehouses. As a result, each virtual warehouse has no impact on the performance of other virtual warehouses. Virtual warehouses can be created, destroyed, and resized at any point of time. Let's say I am using an extra small warehouse and my query performance is not up to the mark. I can resize that virtual warehouse. I can increase the size of the virtual warehouse. Okay, at any given point of time. This is the explicit features of Snowflake. Now, how we will do that? How to, you know, resize or create or delete virtual warehouse? We will see in the virtual warehouse lecture. Now, the third and last layer is cloud services. So cloud services layer is a collection of services that coordinate activities across Snowflake. That means that anything, any activity, be it a select, insert, update, or anything, any query, any SQL statement we want to trigger using Snowflake, it will always route through cloud services layer. Cloud services layer will check that query, like the, you know, the transactions, syntax, semantics, authentication, infrastructure management, metadata management, query parsing, the explain plan, I mean optimization plan, access control, the person who is triggering that query, whether he has that access or not, everything will be checked in that cloud services layer. So the cloud services layer checks everything and make that query execution ready. Okay, it checks everything on that particular query and make it execution ready. After that, it pushes it to the query processing layer. In the query processing layer, using virtual warehouse, it processes the query and it fetches the record from database storage layer. Okay, try to memorize, try to, you know, understand this structure. First, it will go through the cloud services layer, cloud services layer will check all is explain plan, query parsing, whether the infrastructure is there, whether the user is authenticated, whether he has the proper access control from the table it's trying to select. And after that, the query processing layer will put it inside a virtual warehouse. It will process it from that virtual warehouse, and it will fetch the record from the storage layer database. Now, what is query parsing and optimization? Like all queries go, as I said, all queries go through this cloud services layer. Query access control, parsing, optimization, plan are handled here. Snowflake provides us very limited options with respect to performance tuning. Mainly Snowflake handles this performance tuning by itself. Okay, we have a very limited scope to do performance tuning in Snowflake, because in Oracle performance tuning or any other, I have worked majorly with Oracle. So as per my idea, in majorly Oracle uses index. Index is an important parameter to do performance tuning. I believe with respect to SQL Server as well, we have similar things as index. So in this indexing, by using this indexing, we can, you know, like we can use that index in the where clause and improve the performance. We can use you know, function based index, BT index, bitmap index. So all these things is not there in Snowflake. Okay, we don't have any index. We cannot do any indexing. Okay, and I am working with Snowflake for last 3 years. In my overall 12 years of experience, I have never got the opportunity to do a performance tuning of any query in Snowflake, because Snowflake is meant to handle you know, large data sets. Snowflake is petabyte scale data management. So it's like really doesn't matter much, but again, we always need to write a proper query with optimized way so that it incurs us less cost. So we'll see what are the performance tuning options available in the performance tuning lecture. So till now, once this whatever optimization is required is done by that cloud services layer. Once that optimization is done, cloud services executes the query using the virtual warehouse allocated. At the time of execution, it continuously monitors that query and monitors in case of any node failures. Okay. And all query statistics are stored for audit and performance analysis. Like there are many data dictionary views in Snowflake as well, similar to data dictionary views in Snowflake as well, from where we can see the informations, okay, the metadata informations. Snowflake stores all the metadata. We'll see the Snowflake web interface after this lecture today itself, and we'll show you what are the, you know, directionary views and how it captures, what are the information it captures. Okay.
Sir, I have a question here. What are the data sources it will support? It's only cloud platform that I aware of it. And then as per your session.
Yes.
S3 bucket, and then suppose that is having a raw file of like Excel and CSV files or text files or raw data files of like, you know, DBF files. Those will support.
Snowflake mainly supports three cloud providers: AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud. Okay,
that is a platform. I'm talking about files.
Yes. So with respect to files, it supports CSV files, Packer files, Avro, JSON. Snowflake has explicit capabilities with respect to semi-structured data handling, and CSV file, of course. Text file, it can, like if it is if it has a delimiter, we can use it as any delimited file. Raw file, I don't think Snowflake process. Snowflake can process.
So what about like I have a multiple databases, okay, it's which are OLTPs, okay, Oracle, Cassandra,
right,
and I have a like, you know, SQL or like, you know, other databases. So it will connect it to the external data sources and fetch it the same way apart from the storage.
Snowflake can load from the storage, external storage like S3, Azure Blob Storage or Google Cloud Storage. It can load from that internal storage. Snowflake provides internal stage as well. So from our local file system, we can put that file in the internal stage, and from there it can process. Now there are third party tools as well, from where, let's say you have a CSV file. Okay, so there are many third-party tools like Atunity. One is Atunity Replicate I have worked on. So using Atunity Replicate, we can point the source as that file and target as Snowflake. So it can process that file directly from that source to your target. But with respect to data loading, the file has to be in cloud. Otherwise, Snowflake cannot process independently.
Okay. Yeah, on-premises, it will not support. So it is only required.
Yeah. On-premise, if I have a file in my local file system, okay, in our lab, okay, if we continue with this course, in our lab, we'll do that. We'll do that hands-on. We'll put the file from our local file system to Snowflake internal stage because we don't have AWS access. So we need to put it in the internal stage. And from that internal stage, it will process. It will load it inside Snowflake table. Okay. Now, what is internal stage? Internal stage is an area within Snowflake. It's a cloud storage area, you can say, within Snowflake. And we need to put our file using the HTTP put from local file system to Snowflake internal stage.
Got you. Thank you.
Yeah, someone is saying something. Okay. So next is concurrency, how Snowflake implements concurrency. Okay, so let us see this example minutely. So let's say we have an employee table and we have five timelines. Timelines is nothing but just a time interval. Let's say at 9 a.m. in the morning we are capturing it. Okay, so first timestamp is from 9 to 9. 1 minute, after 1 minute, okay, or 5 minute, 9:05. So from 9:05 to 9:10 is the second time interval. From 9:10 to 9:15 is the third time interval, and 9:15 to 9:20, fourth time interval, and 9:20 to 9:25 is the fifth time interval. Okay. Now this is our employee table, and Snowflake maintains metadata internally, so this is a metadata table. Now we'll try to do that. How multiple users are trying to execute, SQL statement on this employee table and how it behaves. So let's say we are triggering query one in the first time interval on employee table. Okay. So in the metadata table, Snowflake stores that table name employee, version is one, and time is time one, that is first time interval it starts. Now let's say on second time interval, someone else triggered one update on that same table. Now with respect to legacy database, that update will wait because the table is in lock. Someone is inserting record, table is locked. But Snowflake will not hold that second query because it provides the shared nothing architecture options, similar to shared nothing architecture options. Okay. So in query two, someone is trying to update the record where the query one, that select is still going on. Okay, it's not completed yet. So what will happen? Look at the metadata table. It marks employee first version as time one, employee second version as dirty. So from it will create another version of that employee table and it will point the query to on that particular version. Now at the same time, if anyone triggers query three, okay, by that time query one is completed. Let's say query one is completed by this time. Now query three got triggered. So in query two, it's updating record, still updating record. Okay, it's not yet completed. Query one is done. Query two is still executing. At the same time, someone triggers query three. So query three will fetch record from employee table version one because that's what the latest copy is. This is still updating. It's not, this updation is not yet done. It's not completed yet. So it will fetch the previous record from employee table version one. Now, if at the same time someone triggers query four, and query 2 is completed by that time. Okay, statement 2 is completed by that time, and someone triggers query 4, try to fetch the record. So it will fetch from employee table version 2, because in metadata table that is the latest timestamp. So employee table version 2, query 4 will fetch from employee table version 2, and query 3 will fetch from employee table version 1, because it has already triggered at that time when this query 2 was not completed. So this thing, I am not sure whether I have explained it properly for everyone to understand. If anyone is having any difficulty, let me know. I'll explain it again. Okay, so I believe everyone understood it.
Please explain it again.
Okay, yeah, sure. So let's say this is an employee table, right? An employee table, you understand this, the timeline part, right? Timeline is nothing but 5 time interval. This is from 9 a.m. to 9:05, 9:05 to 19, 19 to 9:15, like that. Okay. So this is the employee table. Now let's see, I have triggered one query. Let's say insert query or select query, anything from employee table. So it's like select star from employee. Okay. So in metadata, it will capture internally that if on employee table version 1 at 9 a.m., that is the timestamp 1, someone has triggered one select query or insert query. Okay. Now that query is in executing state at the same time at, say, let someone else triggered update. So it will create a separate version. It will create a separate version of the table internally, so, and point that query to on that particular version, update on that particular version. So query 1 will see old data, and query 2 will trigger on that new version. Okay, start updating on that new version, because query 1 is still executing. If query 1 is completed at that time, there will not be any need to create a separate version. So here query 1 is still executing, that's why they point the query 2 on that particular section, that particular version internally. Okay, now in the metadata, it will capture it as query 2 dirty. Now again, someone triggers query 3 at that time, select. Now query 2 is still updating, query 1 is completed, query 2 is still updating. So how to, where that query 3 will point? This is the query 1 is completed, so it will point that query 3 to employee table version 1, because query 1 is already completed. I understand that query 2 has already updated few of the records, but it's not completely done yet. It's still in the executing state. That's why query 3 will point to that employee table version 1. And at the same time, now query 2 is completed and anyone triggers query 4. So what will happen? Query 4 will point to the most updated version. Query 4 will point to the most updated version, and because that's the latest copy of that record, because the update is done. So query 4 will point to the employee table version 2. Clear?
Yes, sir.
Let me know if you have any question.
Yeah, now it is
clear. Okay. So there is query, one concept as query pruning. What I was saying, that mean max max based pruning. Okay. So what is mean max based pruning? Because Snowflake stores uses this mean max based pruning. That is, it captures the minimum value, it captures the range in the metadata. Okay. And it discard the unwanted partition. That's how it implement pruning, that using mean max based partition and discard unwanted partitions. Okay. Now system maintains data distribution information for a given set of data. Most importantly, it is mean max values. All these query prunings is explicitly maintained by Snowflake internally. We don't have to do anything on this. Now we'll see connecting to Snowflake. Okay. So connecting to Snowflake, let us So you the actual Snowflake environment, if I may. Hey, I cannot drag it. Yeah. I have a trial account. I have created a trial account. Well, next day we'll show you how to create the trial account and all. But for now, let me. Just give me a second. Let me open that. You know, so this is my trial account. We will do all our hands-on in this trial account and the course so that, you know, we can do enough practice. So this is how, I'm not sure whether you have got the opportunity to see this Snowflake. This is how Snowflake web interface looks like. Other than this web interface, we can connect with multiple external connectors. These are all external connectors available. See, like client NoSQL, JDBC driver, ODBC driver, Python connector, Node.js, Spark, Golang, and SnowCD. So in this entire course, we will use NoSQL whenever needed for external connection. Other than that, we will just like whatever connector you prefer, you just need to download it from here and install. Okay. But in this course, I will explain everything with respect to SnowSQL only. So this is how Snowflake interface looks like. These are the different databases I have created. Like, let's say I have employee database, and these are the different schema in my employee data table, employee data database. There are two schemas, information schema and public schema. In public schema, I have a table as employee, and if I want to see the record, I can click here and I can see the preview record like that. Okay. And information schema mainly holds, as the name saying, it holds the metadata information. Okay. It has all the necessary tables, like all user columns in Oracle. It has columns, all the database, what are the roles, what are the external tables, what are the file formats, everything. What is the load history? If you trigger any load in a particular table, data loading, what went with that loading? What is there anything? Is there everything all right? From which file it loaded the data? When it loaded the data? What was the row count? What was the row parse? Everything, all information it will capture here. And every time we try to trigger anything, any query, let's say I have this table, right? Employee. So if I write the query as select start from employee and click on run, it will use a virtual warehouse. I need to explicitly mention this virtual warehouse. See, here I have mentioned the warehouse as compute warehouse in this section. So this is explicitly I have selected compute warehouse. I will select the database as employee data and the schema as public. If I don't mention this compute warehouse, it will throw an error, it will not execute. So what does it mean? If I trigger this employee query, it will go through that warehouse. Cloud services layer will first understand this query, check that whether the it is optimized, the person is okay. The Shiba V user has already authenticated himself and it has access to employee data database, public schema, and employee table. Then it will push it to compute underscore WH, this particular warehouse. And it will push it to compute warehouse, and from compute warehouse, it fetches the record from employee table, which is in our storage layer. Okay. So like that, it will fetch the information. Okay. So for this data, it's already there in the employee table. I need to keep on paying the storage cost as long as the data is there. But the compute cost is for the time being, this compute underscore WH warehouse is up. So I executed this query. For that time being, that compute underscore WH is up. And for that time only, I need to pay the compute cost. Now, how this costing works and all in detail, we will see in further lectures. So that's it from my end on today's architecture lecture. If you have any question or if you have any suggestions, I'm open to suggestions. If you have any suggestions or questions, please let me know so that we can plan accordingly.
What about the data security and encryption part?
Yes, Snowflake provides encryption, AS-256 encryption at rest. There are like network security, user security, object security, row-level security, column-level security. So that has a complete separate lecture, how Snowflake implements security. It has a multi-factor authentication as well. It has single sign-on as well, user authentication mechanism as well. So everything is there. It provides industry standard security. Snowflake has four different types of user account. I mean, four different editions: standard edition, enterprise edition, business critical editions, and virtual private Snowflake. So business critical edition is explicitly designed to cater extremely sensitive data. So it has a HIPAA level security. So all these things we'll discuss in that, you know, security lecture. So with respect to the course, if you decide to continue, we will plan soon when, how soon can we start the class. And as I have said at the beginning, that I am not going to, you know, explain SQLs, basic SQLs. You just need to know select, insert, how to create a view, how to create a function, all these things. We'll do majorly hands-on in this course because everything is there in the product documentation, but it's a notion. My job is to, you know, get the information from the product documentation and prepare a material so that everyone can understand. And we'll do the hands-on so that, you know, everyone has the confidence to walk independently. We'll do pretty much everything hands-on, whatever possible and allowed with respect to trial account. I don't have any AWS access at this point, so we cannot load, cannot implement any data loading or unloading using AWS S3 or Azure Blob, but we'll do definitely using internal stage. From our local file system, we'll put the file to internal cloud, and from there, Snowflake will load it, how Snowflake loads it internally. We'll do that hands-on, and of course, we'll explain the rest of the part, like how to do it when it is S3, how to do the continuous loading using, you know, Snowpipe. So all these things we'll discuss and I will do. Okay. So it will be a 10 to 15 hours of learning, 15 hours of learning. And after that, 5 hours of hands-on and doubts clearing and maybe some architecture design discussions, whatever projects I have implemented, I will discuss how I have implemented, how I have used Snowflake there. So that's it. That's what this course will cover. So anyone has any doubt, we can, you know, we can discuss further, or else, yeah, we can close it today.
So how many days coursework is your plan?
I'm sorry?
So how many days do you think you can, is the plan for the coursework?
So it's 1 hour daily. We can plan like, so it's not, look, let me tell you, it's not hard and fast. Okay, let's say for any particular lecture, I planned it in 1 day, but it, you know, it might get extended because someone has having some difficulty to understand it or some roadblock to complete the hands-on, you know. So, but yeah, so that's not the concern. It's not, there is no rush. I will touch each and every point properly. So it's not like 10 hours or 15 hours. It has to be like that. Okay, as long as it's clear to everyone, I'll explain it. But I'm like, we need to plan a target, right? So we're planning it's maximum till 2021 days. Okay, we'll do 1 hour daily on weekdays because I believe everyone else might have some problem if we stretch it more than an hour in the morning. I too have some, and I will be busy from November 2nd because I'll have some seminar and presentations I need to prepare for. So yeah, over the weekend, if everyone is fine, we can plan for a longer session if needed. If you have any, you know, rush to complete the course, else that's how it is.
Okay. And do we need to have an account with AWS and all that?
No, you need to have an account with Snowflake only. Snowflake is a standalone product. It goes hand in hand with AWS, Google Cloud, and Azure. Okay. Now, how to create the trial account and all, I'll explain. I'll show you and you can create it. It's just a 15 minutes, 10 minutes of thing.
Okay. So one understanding I have is that Snowflake is pretty much used for a cloud service and the cluster-based databases and all that stuff. It's much easier and faster. And is it like the future, like an Oracle took a sweep until we have MongoDB and all that stuff? I'm not very sure about the new ones though. But Snowflake, if AWS is contracting with Snowflake, that means it's something really good. Is that how we should think, or do we have other stuffs in parallel?
Okay, definitely we have other stuffs in parallel. We have AWS own product as a data warehouse, AWS Redshift. We have Google Cloud data warehouse product, that is BigQuery. But currently, we have Azure product as well for data warehouse, but currently Snowflake is the best data warehousing product available, and they are continuously improving with respect to this, you know, storage and compute. It has managed the cost to a great extent, and at all three major cloud providers it has compatibility with. So everyone is using, the demand has just started. Okay, and near future, at least near 1 or 2 years, there will be a Snowflake boom. I am sure about that. Okay, if you can learn Snowflake, there will be plenty of career opportunities with respect to data warehouse. Okay, now Oracle will always be there. As of now, whatever the OLTP systems are hosted for huge databases like banking system or insurance systems, 80% of those systems are hosted in Oracle. Okay. Oracle provides a robustness and it has best ACID property for OLTP. It provides explicit locking and all these things. OLTP, I mean, application development, we cannot host on Snowflake. Snowflake is not meant to do that. Snowflake is explicitly built to cater data warehousing need. Okay. So you need to know, you need to have a little bit of idea on data warehouse too, if you want to excel in Snowflake with respect to your career. I hope I am able to answer your question.
Yes, yes.
Saurav?
Yeah.
Sir, currently I'm working on SAP BW and HANA. So my question is it good to move my career from SAP to Snowflake?
So yeah, though I am not the right person to answer this question because it's completely your decision. But I would say that Snowflake will have more demand. If you are interested in this data warehousing, so you can switch to Snowflake. Snowflake will have plenty of opportunities in coming days. Okay.
And now, while getting into the new job, is there not a problem to switch from? Because from starting, I have almost 6 years of experience, and from the starting, I've been working with SAP only. Like, I didn't switch any technology. Now I'm switching the technology. So my question is, while attending interviews, is it not a problem?
No, not at all. The thing is, nowadays the market is looking for someone who is having exposure to multiple technologies. I myself worked 8 years around for 8 years. I worked in Oracle. Okay, mainly with Oracle. Okay. Then okay. I worked 1 year in AWS Redshift. Then. For last 3 years, I'm working in Snowflake. Okay, so if it's the more your experience grows, it's always good to know multiple technologies.
Okay.
Yeah, because Srinivas, this is Shruti, and I worked in PeopleSoft, and most of our PeopleSoft is either Oracle itself. Or SQL database. And then recently I started working in cloud. In cloud, they use Snowflake, but very minimal, basically very minimal Snowflake.
Okay.
So I want to understand how much of an integration with other softwares do they do with Snowflake? Like, if you're going with tools like Pega, like Salesforce, they won't use Snowflake. But anything that
Salesforce and Snowflake, like Salesforce invested a big chunk of rupees in Snowflake. Okay, so Salesforce and Snowflake, they will go hand in hand in near future. Okay, so any data warehouse solution, mostly like 60% of that entire data warehouse solution will be hosted on Snowflake in near future if this fashion continues.
So in that case, this is basically like
an Oracle. It will not be on Snowflake, but data warehouse is going to be Snowflake. Many people, you can see that they have Snowflake, but they don't use it much because we don't have that many Snowflake architects or that many Snowflake experts available at this point of time. So they don't know actually the capabilities of Snowflake, how powerful it is.
So what I mean to ask is, so in the previous years, how Oracle was like ABCD for us, for anybody who wants to develop anything, let it be anybody. I mean, not content writers or business analysts or testers. I mean, even testers need a database. So Oracle was like a staple knowledge for anybody in computers. Like that, do you think Snowflake is going to become that you need to know about how to navigate through it, how to query through it, and understand the architecture?
Yes, with respect to data warehouse, I think Snowflake is going to become that. But product development, it will still be other databases. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, anything, everything is going into cloud. So in that case.
Yes.
Okay, now that you spoke about Salesforce, can you tell me the integration between Pega and Snowflake?
I never used Pega and Snowflake together. I am not aware of it as well.
Okay.
Pega PRPC is totally different. There is no integration with the Snowflake and Pega. Pega have its own features. There is a no code, zero code. You can develop business logic using a drag and drops. That is totally different. And that is totally developed in Java. And coming to the Snowflake, it is just a tool sits on the cloud and multi-platform. It is used as a data warehouse, as Saurav explained. Talking about Synapse, it is a big data tool of the Azure. then you can replace with that. So this is a top on the RDBMS services. You can use and present this tool as a the next layer to the visual like Power BI. That is like UI tool, but this is a totally BI tool with along with a data warehouse. You can store the data, you can fetch the data, you can generate the reports, you can automate the reports, and you can present the layer to the customer. So this is having multiple features. Isn't it, Saurav?
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, then you let your institution know whether you want to go ahead with me or not, and we can plan accordingly on that. Okay.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you for your time, and